did later in the program, but he basically won his case. So let's give a shout out and thanks. He wore a costume of a Grim Reaper and did a dance of death on the railings that the police had set up that are about a foot wide. And the prosecutor couldn't touch him, so he really did defend the First Amendment in a powerful way, and we're so grateful. Now, this evening is a convergence of springtime, which is a time for town meetings around here, so it's a time to bring up this issue of local and international issues in our town meetings. And both Leverett and Amherst will consider these issues. You'll hear the details of these things tonight. Also, besides being about resolutions, at the same time we have attacks going on, as you heard, in Yemen last week, 45 innocent people being killed. We know that they're not telling the truth. They're lying about who is being killed. We can count on that. We don't really know until later who is killed. Sometimes we never know. But the people that are here tonight will tell you about some of that illegal activity. So we want to be conscious of all these issues, and we wanted to educate people about them as they come before the town meetings. First of all, in Leverett, May 3rd, and secondly, in Amherst, we don't know when. Whenever the article number, what is it?
36.
Number 36 will come before town meeting. So without further ado, I'll welcome Nick Modern from New York. He is, Nick has made this drum. He started, that's how I first met him, is, who made those? I heard that he had one that rolled down a walk all the way to Hancock from, I think, Ithaca. And I said, I think I walked with you for a while, so I remember. But anyway, I really wanted to know somebody like that that would put all that effort into educating us about a drum by building a model of them, similar to what our friend in the valley had done with cruise missiles, which I carried on my car for a while. I remember on the roof of my car, my neighbor in Central Mass wondered what the heck was going on. But anyways, Nick is, he's founded a website, nodrones.org. He inspired this action because he's a part of, he founded the Spring Days of Action for April and May, and what else should I say about you?
Well, you should say I'm very glad to be here.
Okay, let's go forward then.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to read this, but also try to move briskly. Is that better? Okay, and I will try to speak for about 10 minutes, maybe no more, because I want to leave a lot of time for questions. And I think, you know, any gathering like this, we have to view as an organizing possibility, experience, not just time to debate or sit with the information and not do something with it. The title of this presentation is Drones and the Death of Democracy. The argument that I'll put forward tonight is that the U.S. government is in the process of building a massive program of drone surveillance within the United States and around the world, intended to repress political dissent and popular organization. The effect will be to eliminate vestiges of functioning democracy. At the moment, most people in this room know, I'm sure, that the United States has been using Predator and Reaper drones to kill people in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Yemen, and Somalia. And this model is a 1/5 size replica of a Reaper drone. The real one has got a wingspan of 66 feet. It's 36 feet long. It carries two 500-pound bombs and four Hellfire missiles. And this particular drone, the Reaper drone, is one that is operated by controllers in Syracuse, New York, but the plane flies in Afghanistan, and it's controlled through satellite communications. And we have, as we'll discuss, we have a number of these control bases in the United States and overseas. We are told that these killings of people in Afghanistan or Pakistan, for example, are precision killings of people who want to attack the United States. President Obama says that these are limited attacks undertaken in a careful way, giving the impression that at some point these attacks may cease, that they are some kind of an emergency measure. This idea is reinforced by reports that the number of drone strikes have decreased in the last few months, even though there is no objective way to know exactly how much drone killing is going on, because for one thing, it goes on in very, very remote places. But the president will not say that the attacks are being phased out, and the Congress is very, very protective of the U.S. drone program. Yesterday, for example, the Senate killed a legislative initiative to try to require the administration to document the numbers of combatants and non-combatants that are being killed by drones. This is the weakest possible notion of congressional oversight that you could possibly come up with, and yet the Congress doesn't want to do that. The stonewalling makes sense for the president and the Congress when you look past the press releases and the headlines to the facts on the ground. For example, a 2012 Defense Department report, as I call it, the War Department, listed 24 existing or planned Predator and or Reaper control bases inside the United States. Those would be control bases, supposedly to control drones flying over other countries. Now, 2 years later, at least six more Reaper control bases have been added to this list, either opened since then or to be opened. Niagara Falls, Des Moines, Iowa, Battle Creek, Michigan, Springfield, Ohio, Nashville, Tennessee, and Horsham, Pennsylvania. And this may not be a complete list of those that were added since 2012 to the list. In addition, every Army division is going to be getting its own drone unit. These will be made up of each one several Gray Eagle drones, which are a beefed up type of Predator drone that will carry more Hellfire missiles than the original Predator. And there will be 152 of these Gray Eagle drones given now to the Army for their use, along with almost 250 Reaper drones, another 200 Predator drones. The plans for construction mean that by 6 years from now, the United States will have at least 600 of these, what they call hunter killer drones. Now, this is on top of probably another 8,000 or 9,000 drones that are smaller and have much more use for surveillance. There's something called a shadow drone. The Army has 14-foot wingspan. Surveillance drone, now able to be equipped with small Hellfire-style missiles. One of them crashed in Pennsylvania 3 weeks ago on a highway in between an elementary school and a motel. Nobody has asked any questions about this. I haven't been able to get out there to look at a police report, but there has been no reporting on why was that drone flying 40 miles away from Port Indian Town Gap, what mission was it on? Do they do surveillance of people on the ground for practice? How is all this working? There is a total silence about this. The United States has at least 10 drone bases overseas, including several in Afghanistan. We are told that we have to keep troops in Afghanistan to protect the drone bases there. We are also expanding our drone operations in the Pacific as part of this pivot to the Pacific and in Africa, and arguing that all of these expansions are for surveillance purposes. None of this takes into account the billions of dollars that are being poured into the development of small drones for the military and the police, such as the T-Hawk surveillance drone being built by Honeywell International. Furthermore, we have to realize that Congress passed legislation 2 years ago opening U.S. airspace to any kind of drone as of September 2015. The law was passed without any hearings in the Congress and without any debate. It passed overwhelmingly without objection. The law makes no provision for the protection of privacy, and it does not prohibit drones from carrying weapons. To enable the introduction of drones over the United States, the Federal Aviation Administration has set up 6 test zones, including one that extends from upstate New York, across Massachusetts, and over to Cape Cod. These zones will be used to develop technology that will enable drones to fly alongside aircraft carrying humans. And the technology is supposed to prevent them from crashing into these planes or crashing into people and things on the ground. Billions of dollars of tax and private money is going into this testing. The FBI has announced that it is using drones now, but it will not say where, and the military has argued officially that it must have unlimited access to U.S. airspace. So what does this mean? When you look at the essence of the power of drones, it is the power they give the operators of the drones to monitor us continuously, all through the day, or to use sensors to see what we are doing indoors at night. The drone's video eye can follow us when we leave the house, see where we go to work, where we shop, where we have lunch. It can see who we meet during the day, with whom we shake hands, who we hug, who we kiss. Then, if the drone is fitted with a weapon, it can kill us on command. The meaning of the eye in the sky, dealing death from the sky, is personally extremely frightening. But this is also has profound political implications in terms of giving drone operators the power to control and prevent political dissent. The drone provides those who are dragnetting us electronically with the uniquely powerful intelligence of the visual, the power to see our behavior and our human associations in a way not possible through electronic eavesdropping or any other means. To understand what our government can do with drones here in the United States, we can look and see what it has done and is doing with drones in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Yemen, and Somalia. Their drone killing has spread. Drone killing has spread as surveillance of those initially targeted leads to more targets. We see people being killed because they are of a certain age, because they are with certain people, because they are behaving suspiciously. In areas of drone operations, we see people afraid to leave their homes, afraid to go to work, afraid to send their kids to school. We see them taking tranquilizers, sleeping pills, afraid to band together even to oppose drone attacks. When I speak on drones, I am often asked, there are so many larger existential issues that we face: climate change, fracking, KXL pipeline, healthcare, Why should I devote my time and energy and money to fighting drones? First thing is, of course, I guess it would be for most people, of course, is that we have to, as we can, stop our government from actively killing people. Rather, that we know people are dying from neglect, we know that they're dying from environmental hazard, we know that the potential for climate change will inevitably kill people, or the climate change will. But for right now, there's a moral imperative of preventing people from being actively killed. But if we step back into our own self-interest here and look into the future, what we can see is that this country is going to have some very profound changes that have to be made. And these will be forced on our government, they will be forced on us. It will have to do with climate change, it'll have to do with energy prices that go through the roof because of wars. It'll have to do with racism because it's intolerable to have mass incarceration. It's intolerable to have immigrants being criminalized and persecuted. It's intolerable to have a tax system where huge amounts of money are flowing totally away from the public interest. These are all things that our government, our military leaders, our police thinkers, the ones who are in the schools for the military, the think tanks for the military, these are all things that they know, and you can read reports about this, are going to lead to huge amounts of civil unrest, huge amounts of dislocation of people. And in my opinion, the government is preparing to deal swiftly and violently with any unrest that threatens the profits and the position of people who are now predominant and controlling of our government in Washington, D.C. Yesterday, I attended a shareholders meeting of Honeywell International because Honeywell makes the engines for the Reaper drones, and it makes guidance equipment, targeting equipment, navigational equipment for the Reaper drone. It also makes these very small drones called the T-Hawk drone that they're trying to sell to the police. And so I read a statement where I said that I felt that what Honeywell was doing with this was basically against its code of ethics, which said it was a law-abiding company. And the meeting was very interesting. It was very poorly attended. There were only 60 people there for this huge corporation that took in $4 billion in sales. Has a huge military aspect to it. And so I read my statement, and the head of the Honeywell's name is David Cote. He responded to me this way. He said, only this. We will continue to abide by all laws. Mr. Cote's salary last year was $28 million. His severance package is $73 million. And from his demeanor, I would say that he's a man who will definitely kill to make sure that the world as he sees it is sustained. So, you should know too, he's also a great friend of President Obama, and who has appointed him to favorable and prestigious positions in the government as an advisor. So what can we do? Well, first of all, here in Amherst, I believe that it would be imperative for people to mobilize to get this legislation passed that at least would prevent people in Amherst from being under drone surveillance and under the threat of weaponized drones. This is something that's happening in other parts of the country. It's happened in Charlottesville, Virginia. It's happened in Lincoln, Nebraska. I think it may happen in Berkeley, California. There's, I think, 8 or 9 other municipalities who passed some kind of limitation on drone. Second thing is, I believe that regardless of what cause, what purpose you are committed to with respect to social justice and environment, you should have a place, you know, on your website, on your Facebook page, where you say, ban drone surveillance, ban weaponized drones. There's efforts being made internationally to do this, in Germany, in the United Kingdom, in Pakistan. And when we begin to realize that the drone issue is not its own issue, but part of every other issue, if we're ever going to change this mess, that's when I think that's when we'll make progress and preserve whatever bit of democracy we might have left on the local level and give us a foothold to deal with our national problem. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nick. I wanted to let people know that we will have time at the end of the program for question and answer period. To facilitate the efficiency of that, I've asked folks to pass out cards, index cards and pens. If anybody doesn't have one, where's Ellie? Ellie's in the back and she can pass them out to you. So if you just raise your hand now while I'm going forward with the introductions. If you don't have either an index card or a pen to write with, that. And I did want to mention for Nick, I'm sorry, I was a little nervous to start out, but I did want to mention that Nick was in the U.S. Navy and in Vietnam in 1962 and 63, graduated from Columbia University's Graduate School of Journalism, has written for newspapers as a researcher, and worked for the U.S. Senate Select Committee on Nutrition and Human Needs. He was a lobbyist for Bread for the World, and a writer and co-organizer of speaking tours in the U.S. and on the involvement of Africa for Mary Noel Fathers and Brothers. And a lot more that I won't go into. We're going to go forward with Frank Gaddy, Dr. Frank Gaddy from Amherst. Many of you already know him. He is a special friend to me, both small f and capital F. He's a member of the Mount Toby Quaker meeting, where I also worship, and we casually had a conversation about the possibility of resolutions last year, and it was too late. So Frank said, when it came about time this year, let's get going. And so he's a child psychologist at UMass and
psychiatrist,
I know that. But he's a child psychiatrist in Worcester and also Westfield rural community. I've also served in Vietnam in 68 and 70, serving on a therapeutic community in Newport, Rhode Island also. And he's a fairly inactive member, he says, of Veterans for Peace. There are other Veterans for Peace members here tonight, including, I think, John Amadon, is that correct? Good. And he worked on a GI hotline and had several children, like Ellie, was helped out tonight, and five grandchildren. So Frank is going to talk to us tonight about the Amherst Resolution and tell you why we should vote for it. Thank you, Frank.
How do I do the slides? Right.
Let me load it up.
Okay.
That was the one on the flash drive?
It was the one on the flash drive. Now you know how people at medical school are taught.
Okay, there with, you go. Now you
with boring see. Slides. So, I'm going to focus talking about the article coming up on town meeting, since that is one of the ways we're centering our discussion, although We also had agreed among ourselves that the most important thing we're doing is publicizing, getting information out. But we are optimistic that we also will pass a resolution. It's Article 36. Town meeting now has gone through to Article 12. So we're not quite sure, probably a couple weeks into May will be when we vote. Oh, so a somewhat irritating and also funny thing happened in the Amherst, in the Northampton Gazette on Saturday. They have a news quiz, which is usually lighthearted and informative. So here you can see item 10 in their news quiz. What do you think the right answer is? Well, of course it's C. Although it's hard to truly recognize it because I don't think we're asking Amherst Town Meeting to bar flights by unmanned drones in the United States as well as use militarily overseas. That's somewhat exaggerated. We're asking much less than that. And I express my displeasure. And accuracy. So what does Article 36 actually say? And it's really, when we went before the select board, one of the questions was, why is there another foreign policy issue coming before Amherst Town Meeting? And I was somewhat taken aback by that because I think, although there's a foreign policy aspect, obviously, it's a terrible thing that we're assassinating people. I have a special concern about the domestic policy, what this means to Americans, and especially about targeted killings, where the president, my God, the president, you know, our president is meeting with advisors, presumably once a week, looking through a list of people who we will kill. We will kill, meaning we the people will kill. He will make the determination. And since his advisors are bringing him the information, I'm sure that Obama doesn't do personal research into each one of these situations. A small number of Americans are killing people in our name. And so that is very much a domestic issue. It's not just a foreign policy issue. The other piece has to do with space above us. We may not know it, or not all of us know it. We own 200 feet above us, property, well, 200 to 500, it's variable. The idea of that is that the commercial airlines can fly above that limit and be regulated because that space is open for commercial flight. There is effort to change the FAA rulings, which have been in effect since 1926, to allow flights, public space to go down to the grass top, which means that drones can appear in your backyard with all the implications of that. And, you know, we sort of know that there are spy operations happening now. When I built a shed on our property and asked for property lines, I was given a photograph from the air of my property lines. So people are taking pictures from above, but somehow it is really creepy to think that someone could be in my backyard. And Paul will talk more about this aspect of it. So this is the actual resolution. There are a number of conditions that lead up to, and this is the actions that we're asking for. So very specifically, we want town to say that no agency in the town of Amherst or any agents in contract with the town can operate drones in the immediate airspace over Amherst in a manner that violates the constitutional rights of its residents. It feels almost redundant, you know, that we are having to say that our constitutional rights need to be respected. And then further it says that the traditional landowner and tenant will continue to have exclusive control of the immediate reaches of airspace, and that no drone, unmanned aircraft, or other airborne object shall have the public right of transience through our property. So this is the important, most local issue. This is not national and international, but it has implications for national and international. I did want to mention there are two kinds of killings. One is the targeted killing. A targeted killing is what we're talking about. A specific person is designated to be assassinated, and a procedure takes place to do that. Perhaps even more destructive are signature strikes. A lot of the time when you hear that a strike took place and there were a small number of civilian casualties, but a large number of combatants were killed, the way combatants are defined is that you see from a distance what a group of people are doing, and you make a hypothesis that this has some anti-American, potentially warlike gathering. So in the movie Unmanned, a group of elders in Afghanistan are meeting together to talk about the problems that have to do with drone strikes, and they're wiped out. They're hit with a drone strike because the group of these men meeting together is seen as potentially a terrorist operation. So signature strikes probably do even more killing. And most of concern from our constitutional rights is that three Americans have been assassinated by the U.S. government. turns out that only one was a targeted assassination, Anwar al-Awlaki. He happened to have Samar Khan, was a friend of his, and they happened to be together when Awlaki was assassinated, and Khan was killed with him. So Khan was an accidental killing, and Awlaki was a targeted killing. And then on October 14th, 3 weeks later, 2 weeks later, the son of Awlaki was assassinated as he was sitting with friends in a cafeteria, in a cafe. And the dead, they all were killed. Yeah, he was killed, he was 16, and he was killed with a 17-year-old cousin. And the U.S. eventually, after hesitating to say why this killing took place, said it was an accidental killing, that an Egyptian was actually the target of the killing, and by mistake he wasn't present, and they mistakenly thought he was, and so inadvertently we killed this boy. So then this is the international part of our resolution, and basically we're saying that the town of Amherst requests our congresspeople to introduce a resolution in the U.S. Congress to end the practice of extrajudicial killing by armed drones, and to specifically withhold money for that purpose and to make restitution. And we try to broaden who it is that's doing it, because there are a number of agencies that are authorized to do drone killings. And I muse just a bit. You know, in my lifetime, we've seen many enemies that we had to defend the world against. And after a while, my work in psychiatry, you begin to realize that in each of us is both capacity for good and the capacity to do bad. And that doesn't matter where you come from or what country or what political persuasion you're from. And so there is this understanding that we are all people capable of both good and bad actions. And the song from South Pacific was many years ago saying that. And I muse a little bit that we had two experiences with people killing on our land. 9/11, of course, where about 3,000 Americans were killed. And by and large, we reacted with rage. That is, within 3 days, we passed through both houses a bill that basically authorized the president to defend us through killing our enemies wherever they might be. And many civil liberties were subsequently also taken away and given to an authority. And then in 3 weeks, we were at war with Afghanistan. And it's always puzzled me how we were at war with Afghanistan when the leaders of the 9/11 didn't contain Afghanis. They were from primarily Saudi Arabia and Pakistan. But we found ourselves at war. And then within another year plus, we were at war in Iraq. So that was our reaction to being having a bombing on our land. We reacted with rage and we attacked. I think that the happening of the Boston Marathon is an interesting phenomenon because so much of the publicity was one of concern and compassion for those who were injured. And although there were less people hurt, we positively reacted to that. We expressed our concern and compassion. And it speaks to the two alternatives that us humans have. And just finally, there's a practical reason that this is a bad policy, forgetting the moral and ethical reasons. And the one is that people do act with rage when their loved ones are killed. And they may, and this is a way to make enemies. And in fact, may make dedicated enemies. And increasingly, we are a frightened people, willing to sacrifice what is seen as traditional civil liberties in order to be safe. And that's not just a luxury. That's all of us in the military took an oath to defend the Constitution. All of the federal political leaders take an oath to defend the Constitution, and yet increasingly to be safe, we consider it less and less important. I didn't know about Lincoln, Nebraska, but I did know about these communities where there have been resolutions passed. Medea Benjamin has come forward and said she is hoping that we can get 100 communities to pass resolutions against drone killing. And so we would like to become whatever number it now is.
Justice maker her whole life. Her commitment has taken her to Afghanistan, Pakistan, Gaza, and Bahrain to stand with the peoples of those countries who have suffered by her government's destruction of life, social structures, and total devastation of the environment. She went to, in 2011, joined Kathy Kelly's Voices for Creative Nonviolence delegation to Kabul, Afghanistan, and where she met the Afghan peace volunteers, a unique group working tirelessly to create a just and peaceful post-US Afghanistan. Will that ever happen? At any rate, in 2012 then, she went joined the Decode Pink delegation to Pakistan and met both families of drone victims and legal advocates attempting to find justice for the survivors and hold the U.S. accountable. In 2012, she was arrested in April 2013. She was arrested at Hancock Air Force Base where the Reaper drone is flown, and also maintain. And having done short jail time, she has an upcoming trial. And back home, she's part of many organizations. She has, she's a co-host of two radio programs, Bread and Roses and Occupy the Airwaves. Her videos can be seen on nctv.org, linking to, what is it?
Protest.
And then / Paki Wieland. So she has, every place we go that she's not speaking, she's taking film. As yesterday, last night, we were at John's trial until midnight, and she was up there doing the legal testimonies, taking camera and film, and also Cornell West earlier in the day. So these are rich films that I invite all of you to look at. She's involved with many organizations. Let's welcome Paki, and she's going to share about the experiences that she's had, the voices of the drone victims, and also how that connects to us.
Hi. I'm almost embarrassed because I know so many of you so well to listen to Beth read that biography of mine, but thanks, Beth. What I want to do for a few moments is just kind of think in this story, as I thought about this presentation, thought about the whole drone issue, to one of the things that struck me is how to sit straight. One of the things that struck me was how we can break apart or to just look at the three different sets of people who suffer by virtue of the drones. And the first people are those who are the obvious victims, the people in Pakistan, the people in Afghanistan, in Yemen, Somalia. And how over the years from 2001, when the United States first started bombing and started its war on Afghanistan, through today, how Islamophobia has deepened in our culture. And I want to read a brief poem that was written by David Smith Ferry, who's a very active member of Voices for Creative Nonviolence. And he wrote this in Bamiyan, Afghanistan. Bamiyan province is one of the places in Afghanistan that there had been a long tradition of Buddhism, and there were many Buddhist statues in Bamiyan. And when the Taliban took over that area, they destroyed all the statues. That's just a side story on Bamiyan. Most of the original Afghan youth volunteers are from Bamiyan province. And this is David's poem. It's called First Night. In Bamiyan, darkness does not deter us. We walk unhurried through a sleeping bazaar. But darkness on silent feet and lashing its tail stalks our host. At dinner, words leaping out of him on clawed feet, 15-year-old Ali asks, "Do Americans think we are animals?" I ask, "What makes you believe Americans think you are animals?" "Why else," Ali responds, "would they bomb us?" And I think that's part of the question that comes up again and again in each of these places. We have some posters around that if you have a moment when the program is over to just come look at them more closely. Because what's happened is that question that the young Afghan lad asked, and the people who are doing the drone piloting, who make bug splats, is just another step in that direction of the dehumanizing of people who have done absolutely nothing to us, who have become the caricature other, the enemy, the person who is not like us, who has at times been animal and at times has been bug splat. And what I love in the posters that have been created is the statement that no, we are not bug splat. That when we read that 1,000 people have been killed by drones since Barack Obama became president, I hear that number, 1,000, and I just kind of glass over because I can't quite comprehend 1,000. But if I start thinking of the little girl in the picture whose mother and father and sisters were killed by a drone, when I think about Karim Khan, the man many of you may have seen on Democracy Now!, whose brother and nephew were killed by a drone strike. He himself, as he spoke out against the drones, both in Pakistan and was on his way to the UK with the Foundation for Fundamental Rights in Pakistan, was abducted and tortured for 7 days, 8 days, before he was released. And I think he was released because, as the people of Pakistan said to us, they know there is a difference. The people of Pakistan will respond in kind. And they know perfectly good and well. It was amazing to be with people in Pakistan who had the sophistication that I don't often find here to make the difference between what the US government is doing and what the people of the United States are doing, because they recognize that you, every one of us, and I, every one of us are on their side, on the side of justice, on the side of stopping the killing. And so they would occasionally say, you're the good Americans, and we'd have to kind of shoot back with that one. But they know the difference, and that's why I think it's so important for us to take these stands. And when there's an opportunity, whether it's for us in Northampton to persuade our city council, or for you who live in towns where you have town meeting, to bring these issues before the town in warrant articles, that it's an opportunity for people to take a stand, and it doesn't go unnoticed. That's a really important part for us to be aware of, that it may be happening in my little town, it may be happening in my city, but as has already been noted, people know, and the word gets out, and it gives people courage to resist our empire. So the two other brief groups I want to just mention are the drone pilots. I remember being in Washington at Freedom Plaza in 2011, when we were having a General Assembly, and one of the conversations was about drones, and there were people who were arguing that drones are better than planes because when you fly drones, fewer people get hurt, fewer people are killed, which of course is fewer Americans are killed, and it led to a lot of really heated and very informative discussions. But what we've found since then, and some other time we can talk with our psychiatrist and others in mental health about what we're learning about the drone pilots, that in many respects they are suffering post-trauma worse than the combat soldier, because what often happens is you're sitting in front of the console and you're encouraged to follow a family, to find out exactly what they're doing. When do they eat? When do they go to school? When do they work? When do they go to the garden? When do they do all these things? And you become intimately aware of these people, and then the commander says, kill them. So I think the second group needs no further explanation. All of these things I'm referring to just kind of thicken this story, are available with good sources through Googling and going to the sources that you already know for good solid information that we're not getting from the federal government. And finally, the third set of people who suffer are you and me. People who don't have good health care, who don't have adequate schools, social services, who have roads that last year I was riding with, many of you remember Bill Norris, Presidente Bill Norris. We were driving together and I said, you know, we really do have third world highways here, third world roads. And Bill said, I live in Thailand part of the year and the roads there are better than these. So I think, you know, we can just see the infrastructure crumbling, and that's how we in fact are bearing the brunt of our military expenses, including vastly the drone programs. The only other thing I wanted to add is the dimension of fear that already has been alluded to, and that is probably the most debilitating, and what it becomes focused on, thanks to a lot of the mass media, is the Islamic people. And I think we can all be aware, and I'm sure there isn't anybody here who's not aware of stories they've heard, anti-Islamic stories, anti-Islam stories, Islamophobic stories. And I think wherever we are, we need to counter those, because it's just another boogeyman. It's just another way of the powers that be keeping us debilitated and keeping us from acting. And so we'll finally end with the question of, yeah, who? Now, let's see, the people of Afghanistan, Yemen, Somalia, Pakistan suffer, our own drone pilots suffer, the people of the United States suffers, and I'll leave you with this question, who benefits? And the solution. I had a letter the other day from Greg Bershod Obed, and I can never pronounce his name. Greg is one of the three people who was arrested at the Y-12 plant, nuclear storage facility in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. They walked in to expose, among other things, how there was not security there and that nuclear weapons do not make us secure. They were subsequently arrested, tried, and are now serving terms in jail. And Greg wrote to me that that he wants us all to be steadfast and resistors. And he said that he was reminded of Gandhi, who wrote in reference to 1 Corinthians 13, and if you're not a Protestant like I am, it might not come to you so fast, but that's the one that says, what is love? You know, it's patient, it's bears all things, it doesn't celebrate anyone's misfortune, it's tolerant, it's caretaking, it's all the good things that you would ascribe to love. And he writes that Gandhi wrote that if we actually lived that, the foundation of the world would tremble. So that's my invitation to let's help the world tremble. Thank you.
Of course, the trembling of the earth cause is what happens in the spring when all the plants are coming up. Seen that happen, and so we know that it is possible for new life to come. Now, even as things are dark and difficult, it's still cold, there's still some challenges before us, but the possibility does exist. We would like to invite Ben Groskop to come up and sing a song which very much applies to what Paki just shared about. And Ben is a celebrated songwriter, singer-songwriter in this community, and we're so grateful to have you come tonight. Thanks,
Beth. This song is by Charlie King, and it's a familiar melody, perhaps, to you, because it's based off of a song that Stephen Sondheim wrote called Send in Your Clowns. Isn't it strange? Aren't we a pair? One sitting safe on the ground, one in midair. Send in the drones, never leave home. Never ask why. One rolls the joystick around, one gets to fly. Which is the drone? Send in the drones. Hundreds are dead, thousands are maimed, digitized dolls on a screen, no faces, no names. Finish my 4-hour shift and I find I'm alone, far from the fray, address unknown. Don't give your name, feel no regret. Ask not for whom the bell tolls, fire and forget. Only a drone, a deniable drone. No problem yet. Isn't it strange? Isn't it queer? Terror remotely controlled, a pilot's career. Where are the drones? Why are there drones? Is anyone
say, I'm the director of an organization called People's Music Network, and what we are, we've been around since the 70s, and we promote music for social change, including on issues of war and peace, as well as many other progressive issues. If you're interested in learning more about PMN and our summer gathering, I got a flyer back on the table or up here up front if you're interested. Thanks, or you can talk to me too.
Thank you so much, Ben. That was beautiful. See a picture. It's more than 1,000 words. Well, music must be maybe 10,000, more than 10,000 words. Thank you so much. Next, we're going to go to Paul Voss, who is an associate professor in Picker and in the Picker Engineering program at Smith College, with expertise in atmospheric science, aerial vehicle design, and airspace regulation. He developed the world's smallest controllable balloons and has used them to study air pollution in the United States, Mexico, the Amazon, the Arctic, and the Antarctica. His designs are currently used in Google's Loon project. I'd like to hear more about that one. And being considered by the Jet Propulsion Lab for a future mission on Venus. Voss is a member of the American Geophysical Union and an associate fellow of the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics. He's also a leading advocate for sensible drone regulations that respect privacy, promote innovation, and affirm local control of the near-ground airspace. His home of city of Northampton recently became the first municipality in the United States to adopt such language, with working closely with Jeff Napolitano to my right, and Paki, Wieland, and others, challenging the FAA and industry view that drones should have unfettered access to our communities and private property. So we're so grateful to have you, Paul. Thank you.
And then we have some slides for this, I think. Okay, so I'm going to going to start, just tell you a little bit in as much as we can fit into 5 or 10 minutes or so. This is an example of a little drone right now. Let me see if I can get this. Do we have a pointer on this? A drone made by a French company, Paradrone. This is something you can fly around with your iPhone, see it through the iPhone screen and see what it sees, like you could see on the right-hand side. And it's just an illustration that this technology is real, it's here, it's in the civilian world, it's in the military world, and it's not science fiction. And so the question that I want to address tonight is one of sort of local importance, which is, if this flew in the airspace around the Amherst in your backyard, would you view that as a public airspace where anyone can fly a drone, or would you maybe view this as your backyard and that little thing shouldn't be in there unless you gave it permission? It might surprise you, but the FAA is moving towards the model where everything is public airspace right down to the grass. And not only do you have no control over it, but you also can't even identify what's there. A lot of the aircraft out there, as you probably know, there's an article in the New York Times the other day about how aircraft are often owned by big complicated trusts and other entities that you can't even determine who owns them. And this structure can easily be, I think in the future, easily applied to drones once they're declared to be aircraft, which they are. Let me go to the next slide. I got a thing here. So this technology is getting ever smaller and more stealthy. This example of a hummingbird drone, you can see videos of it on YouTube. It was developed by DARPA and a company, AeroVironment. It has a little camera on it, and from 30 feet away or so, you wouldn't be able to tell if that thing's a bird or not. And this technology is getting smaller and smaller. One of my students, for example, is working on little drones the size of bees.
I'm
sorry, is that what? Yeah, so one of my students actually is working on little drones the size of bees in a lab in Harvard. She hopes for non-military applications, but none of this stuff is coming out. It's very real, and you should be aware that it's not science fiction. So here's one of the companies that's sort of crossed the line between environmental research in the mid-1990s. It's called AeroVironment. Now they're doing almost exclusively military drones, and now bringing that technology back for surveillance, for selling to police departments, federal agencies, et cetera. This is their product line up here. And you can imagine there's a lot of effort going into lobbying right now in terms of to give control of the airspace to companies like this that produce this kind of technology. And so I'll just show you a couple slides of some of the lobbying that's going on behind their backs. This is an organization, Association for Unmanned Aerial Vehicles International. And they do a lot of promotion of this technology, STEM, science, technology, education, outreach, all kinds of stuff. But they also promote a lot of laws that are beneficial to their largest clients. I should disclose that I'm a member of AUVSI, as many people are who are in the sciences, okay? But I don't like what Heather lobbying. And here's the kind of stuff this slide leaked out. It was a private presentation made by the president of AUVSI to some defense industry folks. And basically, they're bragging here that that the only changes made to the unmanned aircraft sections of the House bill were made at the request of AUVSI. You see in the lower left the little cartoon of AUVSI putting thoughts into the government officials' heads. This is how they view the world. And so this is the kind of stuff we're ending up with. Here are the folks making the rules for unmanned aircraft. This is the advisory committee. It's the advisory rulemaking committee for small unmanned aircraft. This was through a FOIA request. It wasn't even public, like who's making these rules. Maybe we're okay with that when they're making the rules for aircraft operating high in the atmosphere, when they're making rules that apply to your backyards and our communities, and we ought to have some representation. And you look at who's on here. Everyone in red is pretty much military contractors. You can see that Ted Wierzbanowski from AeroVironment is there. As many, many others are as well. And here are the kind of policies that are coming out of the FAA recently. This is a letter that was written to somebody using one of these little, came from the FAA certified mail to someone who was using these little toy quadcopters for some aerial photography. And the FAA basically wrote a letter and said that we saw your stuff on the internet and This is an unmanned aircraft, this little hobby thing. It's a, quote, aircraft, and therefore we have jurisdiction over it. And on the bottom, you'll see highlighted in red that the FAA claims that landowners do not have any jurisdiction over the airspace above their property and cannot prohibit or allow aviation or operations over their land. Well, we're used to that when we're talking about Cessnas and 747s. It's a huge change when we're talking about little things that fly an inch off the grass and we have no control over it and they're being treated like aircraft. This same thinking extends to local control. So even if you don't care about what you can control in your own space, well, it also limits what Amherst and their local towns can do if the FAA takes control of this airspace. Here's a quote from the Assistant Chief Counsel of Regulations in a recent letter to a member of the public, and it says, local jurisdictions do not have the authority to regulate the use of navigable airspace or the safety of flight operations, and local actions to do so would raise preemption questions. Again, most of us are fine with this when we're talking about the airspace 500 to 1,000 feet above us. When that quote applies to everything, the air we breathe and live in and walk in, well, that's a pretty big imposition and a pretty serious change in our environment. And I want to just put a few slides here to show you how far we've come. In the turn of the century, when the first aircraft came, the property owners owned ad coelum, meaning you have local control, local zoning, and landowner control up to the heavens. And so the first aircraft were trespassing, so much so that people thought of all kinds of creative ways to accommodate them. Number one, that they could fly down only public ways, as in this picture shown here. And it took 26, roughly a quarter century to get this right, and it was Calvin Coolidge, who signed into law the Air Commerce Act in 1926, that first established any control of federal airspace. And his main point person on the job was Dwight Morrow, who's on the right in the first picture there, in the picture on the left. And Dwight Morrow was Amherst resident and went to Amherst College with Calvin Coolidge, and they essentially established the whole federal airspace system. So we have a really neat tie here locally to national policy.
And
he was the mayor of Northampton. And so what the Air Commerce Act did, so this is the history we were talking about before, you know, the recent drone advent of drones, was that the navigable airspace above about 500 or 1,000 feet, depending on where you are, was deemed to be public airspace, a public highway, as the Supreme Court used. But below that was the vestige of ad coelum. It was what property owners and local communities controlled, and it was not public airspace controlled by the FAA. And this was later discussed in a number of Supreme Court cases, and all the way up into the 1980s, but the most famous being here, and this is where we're going to end off. If any of you think you don't have a right to some control of the airspace locally, just need to do nothing more than read U.S. v. Cosby. The airspace is a public highway, okay? Yet the landowner must have exclusive control of the immediate reaches of the enveloping atmosphere. Exclusive control is a very strong statement. It doesn't mean drone operators get to fly through that at will. The landowner owns at least as much of the airspace above the ground as he can occupy in connection with the land. Own is, again, a very strong word coming from the Supreme Court of the United States. And the flight of airplanes which skim the surface but do not touch it is as much an appropriation of the use of the land as more conventional entry upon it. In this case, it served as a foundation of a whole number of cases afterwards that has been cited again and again and again. And all of a sudden, in 2007, the FAA issues a policy statement as if this doesn't exist and that all of a sudden these drones have a right to go everywhere. And I think I've showed you who's behind some of the FAA decisions and how the industry's intimately connected into this. And so it's not surprising that they're coming out with a position that's orthogonal to landowner and local interests. But I think it's up to all of us to say that we have some control over our local environment. And I guess the last thing I'll say is every ordinance that we may want to pass about privacy, about anything else, if we don't claim that we control the lowermost airspace, we don't even get to first base. We don't even have any say at the table. So this, I view this establishment of local controls being tremendously important to anything else we want to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Paul. I've learned so much from you over the last couple of months in putting this together, and continue to learn new things. You put so much effort into it, and thank you so much. And also, you're just a very cheerful, supportive person to be around, so it's a pleasure. Jeff Napolitano is an old friend of mine since I've moved to the Valley. He is the program director, he's the program director for the American Friends Service Committee of Western Mass. He's always involved in what's going on, whether it be John Ashcroft coming to UMass, or people fighting for rights to have housing in Springfield. He's a tremendous person and dad, and very knowledgeable about the emerging market of drones in the United States, and that's what his focus is tonight, so thanks.
And I know, I'm very aware that you've been sitting in those seats for a while, so I'm going to try to give you the brief version of this. So my job and my hope tonight is to help folks see the connection between the seemingly disparate sides of this resolution that's in Amherst, and that is what goes on abroad and what happens domestically. Because there is there's a clear connection, I think, to anybody who's really familiar with how this has evolved, and that it would not be an issue domestically if the use of drones did not proliferate in the way that they did abroad. The issues, the problems that we face regarding the proliferation of drones, and by drones, I'm going to essentially mean militarized drones. Dr. Voss flies drones that take atmospheric readings, things that don't drop bombs on people or necessarily spy on anybody. There are legitimate reasons to use drones, but what we're talking about is the use of militarized drones domestically, and we're talking about that because of the use of them abroad in military situation. Drones have been around for a very long time. Model airplanes are drones, essentially. But in the wars of the early 2000s in Afghanistan and Iraq caused an explosion of their use, and therefore their production in the battlefield, these militarized drones. And these militarized drones are a new use of this of drone technology. The U.S. military for about a dozen years was the market for drones, for militarized drones. So for a good 10, 12,